Speaker is Chandrasekhar from IIT Indore. Chandrasekhar, you can make it full screen and start. I will give you a warning at 12 minutes.
All right. Thank you so much. And thanks to the organizers for letting me have this opportunity to present my work. So I am Chandrasekhar from IIT Indore, and I'm going to talk about the impact of light cone on the URC2 line intensity mapping signal statistics. So a bit of an overview of the talk. So I'll introduce UR, then I'll move on to discuss the line intensity mapping to probe early galaxies. Afterwards, I'll talk the simulations that we have done in this course of work, and discuss about the light cone effect and how we dealt with it. So then I will discuss about the how much of an impact can light cone actually have on the observable statistics, and finally I'll summarize the talk. So as all of us are interested in the cosmic time where the first sources of light have emerged, and they started ionizing the neutral IGM from a state of being neutral to ionized. And the broad question that one would like to ask is that how did this process of reionization happen, and what is the physics behind it? So the ways that we can probe this epoch is first by doing a survey of the IGM by detecting the 21 cm signal from the neutral hydrogen of the IGM, which is emitted due to the spin flip transitions in the neutral hydrogen atom in its ground state. So experiments like SK and HERA and many more will do observations which are actually capable of detecting these fluctuations in the signal. So it means that we'll be able to measure the power spectrum of the signal, and this will help us to know more about UR than we do now. So the second way that we might learn more about the UR is by directly surveying the ionizing sources itself. So this technique is known as the line intensity mapping. So what we have here is that it is a clever way by which we, instead of resolving individual faint sources, which are very far away, one instead detects the integrated flux of several sources at once. Within each pixel of the detector. So this gets rid of the problem of trying to resolve very faint sources. And in this way, one can actually manage to do a very large volume surveys of these early ionizing sources within a reasonable time. So a good choice of the line emission for this intensity mapping technique would be the C2 line emission. So this line emission appears from galaxies within which they have ionized carbon present. And basically this line emission is, it comes from a transition between these fine structure states, and it has a rest frame wavelength of 115 micrometers. So what usually happens is that within galaxies, so we might have regions where hot ionized gas is present due to the UV flux from stars. And these free electrons within the hot ionized gas, they interact with the ionized carbon collisionally, and these excite the ionized ions, the C2 ions, so that they then emit this line emission. So that also means that this C2 line emission is very well correlated with the star formation rate that might be happening within the galaxies, and this makes this line a very ideal and reliable tracer of the star forming galaxies. And we also have had surveys like the Alpine ALMA C2 survey, so which have made a survey of 118 star forming galaxies using this C2 line within a redshift range of 4 to 6. So this kind of demonstrates well that the C2 line can be well employed to do intensity mapping for early galaxies. So we do hope that in the upcoming years, line intensity mapping experiments will be a possibility. So one such upcoming experiment is the Concerto mission. So this is an instrument installed in the APEX telescope, and it will target the redshift range of 5.1 to 8.5. Also within this, and also this same science goal is shared by some other missions as well, such as the Secret Prime and the Time Pilot. And this also has a similar target redshift range. So essentially, these all these experiments will also detect the C2 signal fluctuations in the sky from UR in an analogous manner to the 21 cm experiments, and which and this simply means that we'll also be able to measure the usual statistics that we do with the 21 cm experiments in general. For example, we can measure the power spectrum on the of the C2 signal. And another interesting possibility emerges is that we also have the scope for cross-correlating the fluctuations in both C2 and the 21 cm signal from these LIM experiments. So all of this sounds very fine. So one would also like to make predictions about these observable statistics. So the way to do it is that we need to simulate these physics and then predict about and then predict results regarding the observable statistics. So what we have done here is that we have started with n-body dark matter simulation. So this generates dark matter density fields at required redshifts. And then afterwards, we applied the Frenz-of-Frenz algorithm to this density field that identifies the collapse halos. So now one would like to generate the observed C2 intensity map from this simulation. So the way to do it would be to you have to associate C2 luminosity to this identified halos. So for that, we have followed a very simple procedure. So we employ parametric relations so that we can relate the halo parameter to the C2 luminosity. So first, we relate the star formation rate for each halo with its halo mass following this parametric relation picked up from Silva et al. 2013. Later on, we take this star formation rate and relate it to the C2 luminosity using this parametric relation, which is governed by these two parameters, A and B, picked up from Silva et al. 2015. So essentially, then we have a distribution of C2 luminosity within our box, which we afterwards graded. So we have then have a graded map of luminosity distribution, and we further then convert that to a observed C2 map intensity. So that might look something like this. So in this image, we can see that these colored dots are actually tracers of halos using this C2 line. So and the units are here in Jansky-Pass gradient. So this might look like a typical example of the observed C2 intensity map. Similarly, we also simulate the H1 map. So for that, we have used this reionization code available from this GitHub link. And afterwards, so what we have dealt with is the impact of light cones, so which has been one of the major goal of this work. So what this light cone effect means is that since we'll be observing a 3D volume of the sky looking for the signal, so along the line of sight, we'll be receiving the signals from different cosmic times. So along the line of sight, the properties of the signals will be evolving. So it means that within observed volume, the different regions of the observed volume will be at different cosmic times, having different signal properties. And this effect, known as the light cone effect, will have impact on the observed statistics. So to model or quantify that impact, so we have generated light cone maps out of our, the light cone boxes out of our simulated snapshots of Goeval boxes. So we do so by following the formalism of Datta et al. From 2012. So this is done by interpolating each slice along the line of sight in the light cone box from the data that we have in the Goeval box. And finally, to compare the statistics for Goeval and the light cone box, what we do is that we cut out light cone chunks of sizes which is exactly similar to our original Goeval boxes, and then we compare their observed statistics. So this is a example of the impact of light cone on the C2 power spectrum. So on the left hand panel, what I'm showing is the power spectrum for the C2 signal. So this solid line over here is the power spectrum for the Goeval boxes at different redshifts, depicted in different colors. And the dotted line shown here is the power spectrum for the light cone chunks. And the deviation of this light cone power from the Goeval one is quantified in the right-hand panel in percentage. So we can see that at relevant length scales, that is for lower chemos, we can have actually a significant impact due to light cone on the power spectrum. So that can go as high as up to 15% in this case. Next, let us come to the discussion of C221 cross power spectrum. So this is defined in the following manner, which is analogous to the power spectrum. So we have delta C2 and delta 21cm, which are the fluctuations in the signal in the Fourier domain, and we correlate them. And the, on the right hand side, the quantity that we obtain is the cross power spectrum. So now one might be interested in this statistic is because this cross power actually carries information about the reionization history. And secondly, this statistic is a more reliable one and more robust than the usual H1 power spectrum, in the sense that it is less susceptible to contamination. So a typical behavior of the cross power might look something like this. So these two different curves are actually the cross power behavior with redshift for two different sets of UR parameters. And this is taken at a fixed K mode. So you see that the cross power can track reionization history, and also the behavior is, it has a distinctive behavior signature for different set of UR parameters, meaning that using cross power, we can very well constrain the reionization history and the UR parameters. So then this means that it is worthwhile to also look at the impact of light cone as well, or light cone on the cross power as well. So for that, we first need to understand that the light cone effect that we are talking about in the case of cross power is actually dependent on the reionization history that we are dealing with. So for example, for the model history H2, which actually falls off much faster with redshift, so the neutral fraction changes much faster for this set of parameters, the light cone impact in this case will be much more drastic as compared to the history shown here for the model H1. So in the left-hand panel, I am showing the variation of cross power with chemo. So these different colors show different redshifts with the corresponding.
Chandrasekhar, you have 3 minutes left.
Okay, thank you. So these colors show different redshifts with associated neutral fractions here. The middle panel shows the corresponding cross correlation coefficient, and on the right hand panel, I have shown the amount by which the light cone has impacted the cross power in this case. So in some cases, we can see that the light cone effect can also be very drastic in certain cases. So, and for depending on the reaction history, that impact is more drastic. So for example, in this curve, in this redshift, so while it exceeds 15% here at this demo, so for model history H2, it can go beyond 20%. So meaning that if we have faster evolution, it will have more drastic, the light cone will have more drastic effect in the observed cross power. So this now brings us to the summary. So what I've told is that line intensity mapping is a complementary probe of the UR to the 21cm surveys. And also light cone effect can have a very appreciable impact on the observed statistics, that is on the observed C2 power spectrum and the C221cm cross power spectrum. And that amount can be anywhere within 0 to 15%, or it can be even more, depending on what kind of reaction history we have. And so this has a key implication that if one is interested to constrain the reaction history and your parameters with these with this cross power statistics, so then the LC effect has to be taken into account. So I will end by adding that while this analysis is worthwhile, so it will also be interesting to look at the detectability of this cross power statistic to actually understand that how this cross power performs while constraining the reionization history and the UR parameters. So with that, I'll stop here, and thank you very much.
Thanks, Chandra. So the floor is now open for question. I already see there is Shuman is saying I have a question in the chat box. So please go ahead.
Right. Hi, nice talk, Chandra. So I had two naive questions. First of all, when you compare your effect of the light cone effect in the power spectrum for C2 and the similar thing you do for cross power spectrum, do you see similar trend along redshift? And the second part, like it increases with the increment in the redshift or something like that? Or, and the second question is, you see, when you compare the cross power spectrum effect due to light cone, there is a sign change, and like, why, what does it signify? And that's it.
Yeah, so if you're talking about redshift evolution, so in the case of C2, we actually see the impact of light cone is kind of declining here.
With increasing redshift, yes. Do you see?
No. Actually, I think it's the other way around. So, for decreasing redshift, the light cone impact declines here. So, for redshift,
same thing, right? It increases with redshift.
Yes. Right.
And now, if you compare it with the cross power.
Yes, for cross power, so that is not very obvious, but most of the changes is actually in suppression. So your cross power is suppressed compared to the covalent. And regarding the sign change, so in the K modes that we have done here, the correlation is negative here. So all of these. So there we do not have sign change. So, but for let's say higher K modes, we might see that.
No, you see in the redshift, you have a sign flip, right?
Sorry, I didn't get
your blue curve is positive somewhere, and then your green and
okay. Yes, so this means that the impact of light cone is such that somewhere it enhances power, and at some K modes it suppresses the power. Okay, and yeah, so that nature is dependent. I mean, it varies with K actually. But in general, I mean, there is no, I think in case of crossover, there might not be such kind of general trend that you have a monotonic change in the percentage change with redshift. So for example, in the middlemost redshift, you have maximal change here, but again, as for the lowest redshift here, you again have suppression going on and enhancement, and then again as K mode declines, so the change also change, the percentage also declines to negative. So it's kind of there in this case.
Okay, thank you.
Right.
Yeah. Any other question? I don't see any hand raised.
Can I then ask a question?
Yeah, please go ahead.
Question? Okay. So a nice talk. So I'd like to mention that you may know that this line C2 and CO follow the galaxies, right?
Right.
And so you may know that there are analytical form for this light cone effect. So you can analytically calculate what is the basically would be the light cone effect. So galaxy survey people have already done those things. So have you compared those analytical form?
Okay, so what you mentioned there is something interesting that I would want to look at. So I was actually not that aware of the light cone effect. So there is
those are at lower redshift, but the analytical form you can extend to any redshift. I hope.
Right. So if that is the case, yes. I mean, it would be interesting actually to compare this.
So as Suman was asking, so there is a, so if you go to slide number 10, so there is a increase then a drop at very large scale. So do you know why is this happening? Means what is the physical reason behind this?
Okay, rise, so I mean, yeah, so I mean, this drop, I mean, I am not very sure of whether this might be physical, because the error bars are actually quite large, meaning that the sample values, I mean, the sample numbers for the within these k-modes, I mean, they decline, right? So, I mean, this might also be a, due to a fluctuation. I mean, you cannot quite be sure that whether this is a physical effect or a statistical fluctuation. Yeah, so one needs to look into this.
Yeah. So Rajesh, hello Rajesh. I think that we should move the discussion to the Slack channel now. So we are running out of time. So should we move to the next talk? Yeah. Please continue the discussion on the Slack channel. Three, can you please share your slides? So I'll give you a 12 minutes warning at 12 minutes. Atri, can you speak? We cannot hear you.
I'm audible right now.
Yeah, fine.
And you can see my screen, right?
Yeah, yeah.
Let me just put it in a present as slides.
Presentation.
Yeah. So and you can see my cursor, right?
Yeah, yeah. Go ahead.
Thanks. Okay. So first of all, I would like to thank the organizer for giving me the opportunity to present my work here. So today I will talk about a recently developed pipeline that I, along with Tirth and Saurav, has developed. It is called Cosmodia and MC, and it is a parameter estimation package. And we have submitted the paper in MNRAS. And if you are interested, it is also in the archive. And so you can take a look at it if you like. So, okay, so let's start. So first I will give a like kind of an introduction from a point of view which we all know. So as we all know that the CMB photons which comes from redshifts 1100, they interact with the free electrons in the IgM produced at the time of epoch of reionization, and their effect is imprinted in the CMB angular power spectrum observations. And using this fact and assuming some kind of a reionization history, one can actually compute the Thomson scattering optical depth tau, which is kind of straightforward. And now, once you got this tau from observation, you can compare the value of the observed tau with that of your reionization model to constrain free parameters of the model. So what I meant to say is that in one hand, you can calculate, so let's say you propose a reionization model. Now in one hand, you can calculate the tau from your model, from your own reionization model. And on the other hand, you have the tau which has been observed by Planck measurement. And now you can compare the tau you got from your own model with the tau that has been given to you from observations. And using this, you can actually constrain free parameters of the model. And this is a very widely used techniques to constrain the free parameters of reionization model. However, there is a catch. The catch is that when you compare the two values of tau, now the value of tau depends on the reionization history used. Usually when you got that tau from observation, it means that they usually use tan hyperbolic kind of a reionization history, whereas your own reionization model is probably more physical than this. So the problem is that you are not exactly comparing in the orange with an orange. So the comparison is not fair, you know, in a sentence. Now to overcome this problem, what one can do is one can connect a reionization model with a publicly available CMB anisotropic code like CAMB or CLASS, and then can constrain their cosmological and astrophysical parameters simultaneously. So what you basically want to do is that you got your reionization history from your own numerical or from your own reionization model, and then feed that as an input to the CAMB or CLASS. Usually CAMB or CLASS have tan hyperbolic reionization. So you input your the reionization history that you got from your model into the CAMB or CLASS's input. And then can constrain the cosmological and astrophysical parameters. By astrophysical parameters, I mean the parameters, the free parameters in your model simultaneously. And remember that you need to do this simultaneously because it has been shown that there could be some degeneracies among cosmological and astrophysical parameters. So we want to do it simultaneously. So this is like one of the goals of our pipeline, Cosmodia and MC. And another and very important aspect of our code is that So we have seen, this has been noted for a long time, that when you model the 21 centimeter signal, and there are so many talks about 21 centimeter signal in this workshop, so you can actually model. So when you want to model the 21 centimeter signal, you need to take into account some cosmological parameters that people usually take from Planck data. Now I want to demonstrate the effect that the cosmological parameters indeed determine the shape, indeed can determine the shape of the 21 centimeter signal. So here I want you to look at this figure. So in the x-axis I plotted the dead shift, in the y-axis we have plotted the 21 centimeter signal brightness temperature. Okay, and now these, for these two curves that you can see, one is in like red and one in probably magenta. So for these two 21 centimeter signal, we did not change any other mod, any other cosmological or astrophysical parameters other than the sigma e. So in for the red one, the sigma it is 0.81, and for the magenta one, the sigma it is 0.76. And you can see that because the sigma it is high for the red one, it means that the structure formation has started early. As a result of which, the absorption dip in the 21 centimeter signal has taken place earlier. Whereas for a sigma it which is less than that, the dip has taken place at a later date. So you can see that there is indeed some effect of cosmological parameters while determining the form of the 21 centimeter signal. Okay, so keeping these two things in mind, we have developed this Cosmorea and NC pipeline. So let us first look at the left hand side of the slide. So this this pipeline has been written completely in Python, and I have tried my best to make it as readable as possible. For example, it uses all kinds of features from the class in Python. And in this model, we have embedded in it three theoretical models. One is the CAM, which is like the publicly available code. However, we have to edit the code in also that to make sure that we can indeed feed our own reionization history to that CAM code. And we also developed a 21 centimeter signal code, and also we have a reionization code. So there are three theoretical models that has been put into this. And on top of that, because we are using Markov chain Monte Carlo process, we need to compare the observable that come from the theoretical model with some observations. And in our case, we have used three observations. One is the Planck 2018 observation, and these observable like the CLs, the power spectrum, CMB angular power spectrum, will be produced from the CAM. There are some quasar observations, which I will talk in detail what I mean by that in a bit, which comes from the reionization code. And then there is the edges signal, which you all know, which would be produced from this 21 centimeter signal model. Okay, and for all the MCMC purposes, we have extensively used a publicly available software called EMC. And this EMC has been written in Python. So we have to write the whole code in Python as well. And in our this package, the free parameters are like three category of free parameters. One is the cosmological, which will be denoted by theta cosmo, which basically, for example, takes into account H0 or say omega B, omega C, and so on. Another is the reionization, which I will come in a bit what I mean by reionization free parameters. And there is another set of free parameters which come from 21 centimeter signal, and which again I will come in a bit. So, and this is, I tried to put a flowchart of how this code works. So all the things that you can see here is basically kept as a black box in our code. So for the user who want to use it, we'll give all the free parameters somewhere here outside the code. And once it gives all the free parameters, which has been now categorized into three parts, one is the Cosmo, the one is the reionization, and one is the 21 centimeter, will be used in different segment of the theoretical model. For example, in reionization, we will put the three parameters corresponding to cosmological and reionization. For the CAM code, we will put the cosmological parameter, and for the 21 centimeter, again, cosmological and 21 centimeter. And from this reionization code, we will get the QH2, which is nothing but the ionization fraction, to our CAM code, to the CAM code. And this rho star 2 and rho star 3 dot are basically the star formation rate density for POP 2 and POP 3 stars, and which I'll discuss in detail in a bit. And this we will put in that 21 centimeter model. And once we have done this part, the ChemCAD can produce the CLs. The reionization will produce something called Lyman limit system distribution, which I will again come in a bit. And then the hydrogen photoionization rate. And the 21 centimeter model obviously will produce the 21 centimeter signal. And once we got all these four observable, then we will compute the likelihood that has been done here, mostly driven by EMC code. And then we will check if the parameter converges or not, if the run converges or not. If the run does not converge, then we will put it in a loop, as you can see from here. Again, it will take some different set of parameters and so on. And once we are satisfied with the convergence criteria, we will put all these constraint for other post-processing, for other purposes of post-processing. So that's the idea of that code. So now I will discuss the reionization model first, because this has been used extensively in this code. So our reionization model is based on Chaudhary and Ferreira's 2005-2006 paper. So the overdensities in this reionization model, the overdensity in the low density region of the IGM follows a log normal distribution, and then it changes to Parlor distribution in high density region. And this idea has been implemented from Miranda Iscori 2003 paper. And then the sources of reionization in this model are quasars, POP2 and POP3 stars. However, in this talk, I will not talk about quasars at all, because so far we have not implemented anything with helium reionization and so on. So we will mostly focus on POP2 and POP3 stars. Now, in order to estimate the contribution of POP2 and POP3 stars, we need to know the Kolas fraction. And this I have tried to put it in these equations. Okay, so let's see. So for example, this rho m is nothing but the co-moving density of matter density, co-moving matter density. And m mean is the minimum mass for star forming halos, which has been calculated, taken into account properly the radiative feedback, otherwise your model is not very reliable at all. And then this del n del m is nothing but the mass functions. And in our case, we have taken set term and mass function all over this world. However, there is a catch. The catch is that how do you calculate POP2 and POP3 stars starting from a single model? And the most important thing to note here is that you need then some kind of a mechanism which will make sure that the POP3 stars have stopped at some certain rate shift, and there will be a smooth transition from POP3 to POP2. Okay. And this kind of a semi-numerical work, it is hard to do it in any detail. So we have kind of taken into account some kind of a simplistic model. We have used this F3 function for that. And we have assumed that this transition takes place via tan hyperbolic function, as you can see here. So J trans is the transition rate shift, which is used as a three parameters in our model. And delta J corresponds to the dynamical time scale of the halos. This comes from the fact that we assume the star formations in a halo takes place at dynamical time scale. That's the assumption goes here. Okay, so now that we know what is the Kolas fraction for POP2 and POP3 stars, the next task is not that difficult. So all we need to do is to calculate the photon production rate from stellar sources, and that can be calculated in this fashion. So let me just tell you what are the different notation tells you about. So rho b, as you can see, it is the mean co-moving baryon density. F star is the star formation efficiency. F sk. Yes, sorry.
Sorry, you have 3 minutes.
Okay, yeah, fine. Okay, okay. So the sk fraction of ionizing photons is denoted by F sk, and whenever you will see some kind of a subscript 2 or 3, it basically comes from POP2 or POP3 stars. Okay, so now in this fashion, you can calculate the photon production state. And the observable quantity that comes from the reionization model are nothing but, for example, used in this code are ones what are called the Lyman limit system, and another hydrogen photoionization rate. Okay, so and to calculate both these quantities, the DN, LL, DZ, and gamma PI, you have to have calculate the mean free path, and this has been calculated in this fashion. And lambda zero is again a free parameter of our model. And for the 21 centimeter signal, I will not spend much time. I will just say that the X-ray hitting can be modeled in these fashions, where we have taken into account, where we have assumed that the relation between the X-ray emissivity and the photon and the star formation rates are driven by our present universe relations. Except we have introduced a parameter called FX. FX basically captures all the uncertainties that comes due to the fact that we are working on high rate shift universe, which is very uncertain. And FH comes from the fact that all the X-ray will not go into hitting, some fraction of it will only go into hitting. And similarly, you can calculate the Lyman alpha coupling coefficient, and again an unknown normalization parameter will come, which is again given by F alpha. The radio emissivity you need to calculate, because we have assumed that we must give some excess radio background, otherwise we will not be able to produce the 500 millikelvin dip, and it has been calculated like that. And again, you will face an uncertainty parameter called FR here, as you can see. And our background temperature will begin TCMB plus TR. TR comes from the radio background. So to make it in more detail, though I don't have much time, so when we take into account all these things, we have these three parameters, and if you count, you will actually find that we have used 12 free parameters in total, and we have defined different likelihood like this. The Planck likelihood has been taken from their own website, and on top of this likelihood, we used constraint. One constraint is that Gries have also mentioned in his talk, that reionization must be completed at this redshift. And we also used a constraint from upper limit on neutral hydrogen fraction, which comes from dark fractions in quasar spectra. And the good thing is that we have found that all these 12 free parameters indeed converges, and we can produce this triangular plot. But just to make it more simpler, I will show you this plot, where we have just taken a chunk of it, which the important thing to note here is that there is a strong positive correlation between tau and FESC, as you can see from my cursor. This is again expected, because if you increase the escape fraction of up to stars, it means that the tau will increase, and you will find that tau and lambda zero actually anti-correlates, and that comes from the fact that when you calculate the different observable, one of them was gamma pi, the photon production rate, and in fact when you calculate this quantity will come as a product, like tau times lambda zero times FESC. And that's why you will see some anti-correlation between these two parameters. Okay. And another important thing to note here is that the Z trans, which is the transition redshift, has been well constant between 15.89 and 16.60. We also found a strong correlation between these two quantities, the F3 star R and FXH2. And this comes from the fact that the radio emissivity always, like the radio things always try to keep your signal as deep as possible, whereas the X-ray hitting wants you to keep the signal towards zero values, like delta TB will come to zero for this. So that's why it shows some kind of a strong anti-correlation. So then we come to the cosmological parameters, constant and cosmological parameter coming from different analysis. And so I will not go much detail. I'm almost done. It is the last slide. Okay. So all I want to say is that when we introduce the reionization constant and the reionization observable, we find that the tau and sigmoid constant is very tight, as you can see from here. Okay, whereas these come from when if you take only the CMB observables, like only the CLs. And I will leave you with the summary slide. Thanks.
Thanks, Atri. Time for questions. You may raise your hand in the... Yeah. Avinash, please go ahead.
Yeah. Hi, Atri.
Yes.
I'd like to ask that what is the physical motivation behind taking this tan hyperbolic function of the transition between pop 2 to pop 3?
In fact, it is the ulta. It is just that we cannot really physically...
Pop
3 to, yeah. It is actually exactly the ulta, that we have to have taken some kind of a simpler thing. We have to make sure that the pop 3 to pop 3 transition will happen. Now, we do not have any physical model to do that. So that's why we have taken a much simpler approach. approach, just assume that it kind of follows a tan hyperbolic way, that the POP3 will POP3 star formation will end, and then the POP2 star formation will start. At a rate, yeah. Let's say J trans, the transition rate set.
Yeah. Any other question? I have not seen, I don't see any other hand raised. Maybe I will ask a quick question, which is how much computing power and time does it take to?
Okay, so I used it in a cluster in NCRA, where we have used, I believe, 28 threads, and it takes around 3 to 4 days to convert on this.
Okay.
Just to add your question, so it means you are very fast.
Yeah, indeed, it is very fast. Very fast. I mean, then we have put a lot of effort to optimize the timing when we write it in Python.
So why don't you try these upper limits, MWA low for?
What?
The upper limits results from MWA and low for.
You mean power spectrum or?
Yes.
No, we have not used any power spectrum kind of thing here. So okay. that's
simply no, this is rather
likelihood you can include those, right?
But you have to make sure that I understand. But I have to produce that in our code, right? Right now, this code does not produce any power spectrum.
Okay.
Maybe we should stop here. If Atri can unshare his slide. The next speaker is Barun from NCRA. Barun, can you share your slide?
Yeah. Am I audible?
Yeah, you are audible. Can you make it full screen?
Yeah, yes, sure.
And I will give you a warning after 12 minutes.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, please go on. Thank you.
So I'll be talking about inclusion of inhomogeneous recombination and feedback in Strict. From the earlier talks in this workshop, we have learned that the annihilation modeling is very important to correctly infer the observational data we have or which are going to come in near future. So Script is basically a semi-numerical code which is used to study the reionization. So let me give a brief introduction about the annihilation modeling. So in general, it can be done in two ways. So one is to go for a full radiative simulation where you include rigorous physics, but those are computationally much more time consuming. So we cannot do any parameter statistics kind of studies with these, given the fact that there are a lot of uncertain parameters in those early ages. So the way out is to go for a semi-numerical kind of approaches where we compromise a bit with the accuracy, but the necessary physical insights are well captured in these models. And the advantage of these models is that they are reasonably faster than the full radiative simulation. So we can do parameter statistics of studies where we need a lot of realizations. And Script belongs to that second category. But before going to Script, I would like to give a brief overview on general semi-numerical models, which are mainly based on excursion set. So what are the different parameters involved there? How do they work? We need to know a bit about that. So the essential idea is that we have two input fields. One is the density contrast field, and the other one is the collapse fraction field. That is the fraction of mass collapsed inside a halo above a minimum threshold mass, say M min. And these two can be got from any n-body simulations. And from these two given input, we have to tell whether a region or a cell in that field is ionized or not. So to do that, we take the cell where we want to know the ionization state and draw a sphere of radius R. It starts with a maximum radius, say R max or R MFP. And we compute the average of this quantity, collapse fraction multiplied with the overdensity for all the cells inside that sphere. And this will give a measure of average collapse fraction inside the sphere. Now we have to have some measure of the ionizing photons, number of ionizing photons. And that comes via the parameter which we call ionizing efficiency or zeta. This is a measure of number of ionizing photons per unit hydrogen atom. So if we multiply it with the collapse fraction and if this quantity is greater than one, then we shall say that there are sufficient number of ionizing photons to ionize the cell, and we flag that cell as ionized. If not, then we will decrease the size of radius and do the same procedure until we get the cell as ionized. And even after reaching the resolution of the cell, if it's still not ionized, then we will assign a partial ionization fraction of zeta multiplied with collapse fraction of that particular cell. So this approach works fine until the two ionized regions starts to overlap. When they starts to overlap, then there seems some problem with photon number non-conservation. That means the number of available ionizing photons is not equal to the number of atoms ionized. So physically, these two quantities should be same. And to tackle that problem, script was introduced. It stands for semi-numerical code for reionization with photon conservation. So it basically takes into account individual photon instead of doing that average kind of thing and distribute excess photons to nearby cells. So in some sense, it is explicitly photon conserving. And that that is the precise statement of photon conservation, that the number of ionizing photons produced by the sources in halos should be equal to the number of hydrogen atoms ionized. And script has also other consequences, like it produces resolution independent power spectra at large scale. So whatever small scale physics you include in your simulation, the overall large scale feature should be intact, because this is going to be an observational probe in future. So script provides that, while the other excursion set based approach fail to do that. And now move to the modifications done in script. The first one is due to recombination. So recombination is nothing but an ionized atom can capture an electron to again produce the neutral atom. So if the recombination is absent, then we would have just compared the number of photons and number of hydrogen atoms. But in presence of recombination, we need to take into account that excess neutral atoms which are coming due to recombination. And this term is given by this n recomb, which is basically the recombination number density. And this can be calculated for a particular rate shift interval if we know the number densities of hydrogen atom at each rate shift and the ionization fraction at each rate shift. So we have the density contrast field, so we know the number densities, and we can calculate the ionization fraction self-consistently. So in principle, recombination effect can be included. And for that, we need to have another parameter which basically quantifies how inhomogeneous the medium is, and that is called the clumping factor. Or in the other way, it can be said that it basically gives the strength of recombination. So if the clumping factor increases, the strength of recombination also increases. And the second effect is the radiative feedback. So as reionization proceeds, we know that the medium heats up and the temperature increases. So as the temperature increases, the minimum mass above which halo can collapse and efficiently form stars also increase. So there will be effective decrement of star formation for a halo mass which are less than some threshold mass. And if the star formation is decreasing, then the proton production will automatically decrease, and this will in turn affect the reionization. So this can be modeled via this that m-min parameter, which I have told earlier. It in general taken as the atomic maximum between atomic cooling mass and some threshold mass, which is temperature dependent. And here we have modeled the radiative feedback in these three approaches. The first one is step feedback, where we assume that there is basically no star formation for a halo mass which is less than some threshold mass m min. So it is a sharp cutoff in star formation, and above that halo, above that critical mass, it is all allowed. And instead, we could do a gradual kind of suppression for the star formation, where we assume that it goes like this factor 2 to the power minus mg by mh. So when the halo mass is much, much less than the threshold mass, it will basically go towards zero, and if it is much, much greater than the threshold mass, it will go towards one gradually. So however, to compute that threshold mass, we need to have some information about the temperature, as it is temperature dependent quantity. And to do that, we take the standard temperature evolution equation. So we know that there are in general three terms which are relevant at this era. So the first one is the reionization heating. The second one is the cooling due to the Havel expansion. And the third one is the heating or cooling depending upon the structure formation. And for reionization heating, we model it in a simplistic way. So for a general partially ionized cell, there will be two contributions. The second one is due to the increment in temperature due to the increment in the ionization fraction. So it is proportional to the rate of change of ionization fraction, and it is proportional to a quantity which we call TRE, which is basically giving a measure of temperature increment if a cell goes from fully neutral to fully ionized state. And the first term is basically the contribution of heating due to those portions which are already ionized in a partially ionized cell, assuming that these portions are in ionization equilibrium. So what are the effects? In this figure, we have shown the plots of light cone for different combinations of with and without recombination and feedback. And we have assumed the same ionizing efficiency for all the four cases. For the top panel, we have we don't have any recombination or feedback effect. In the second panel, we have included the recombination, but no feedback. We see that the ionization is extended bit towards lower dead shift. And if we add feedback effect on top of that, it is expanded a bit more towards lower dead shift. And the effect is same for step and gradual feedback. And what's the effect on power spectra? So let's just concentrate on top panel. The top panel is basically step feedback, and the bottom panel is the gradual feedback. The essential effect is basically same. So in the three top panels, we have shown the power spectra for three different global ionization fraction. And the red curve are showing the cases where we have included the recombination and feedback effect. And the blue curves where we don't have these effects, but tune the ionizing efficiency to get a similar global ionization fraction. And we can see that there is a suppression at large scale power spectra. So now we can use these modified models to do parameter statistics kind of studies. And before going to that, I'd like to introduce another observational probe which we use in our studies, that is the UV luminosity function, which is basically the number of objects per unit cone volume per unit UV magnitude. And we have the information of halo mass function via the collapse fraction we have calculated earlier. So in principle, if we can convert the UV magnitude to mass bins and assume that each halo can contain each galaxy or each object, then we'll be able to compute the UV luminosity function. And for that, we need to introduce another free parameter, which is basically giving the fraction of ionizing photons, which are able to escape the halo and ionize the medium. And this is called the escape fraction. So these are our free parameters and the priors. So we have used redshift dependent ionizing efficiency in general. So zeta naught is the ionizing efficiency at redshift 9. Alpha gives the redshift dependence. And reionization temperature, which I mentioned earlier, and we have also used mass-dependent escape fraction in general, where if escape naught is the escape fraction for a halo of mass 10 to the power 9 solar mass, and beta gives the mass dependency. And these are the observational constraints we used. So we have used model-independent limits on ionization fraction, which is basically coming from the dark pixel statistics for quasar spectra, CMB scattering optical depth measured by Planck, recent measurements of IGM temperature, and UV luminosity functions at two redshifts. And we have also assumed that no reionization model is allowed to go beyond redshift 5.3. And these are basically the results. So left sides are for the step
feedback. Varun, yeah. You have 3 minutes.
Yeah. Okay. So step feedback, and the right hand side is the gradual feedback. We see that the parameters are reasonably well converged. And we have also shown the plots for two different kinds of clumping factors. One is the constant one, other one is the redshift dependent one. And we see that the parameters do not depend much on what kind of clumping factor we use. And similarly, the trend of gradual feedback. And now we plot 100 random samples from our posterior distribution. same for step feedback and residual feedback. And to remind that we have only used these three lower limits on the ionization fraction from that model independent studies. But we can see that other high rate shift constraints are well satisfied by our models. And for the step feedback, we also see that our late reionization end is preferable. It's ending more or less between 5.5 to 6.1 or so. And the trend is more or less similar for our gradual feedback, but there are still a lot of models where reionization end is at earlier rate shift, and those are also those are allowed for a gradual feedback like case. And these are the plots of UV luminosity function for these two cases. The main difference basically coming at the fainter end of UV luminosity function, where for the step feedback we see a visual like a visually turnover like thing. On the other hand, for the gradual feedback we don't see it, and it is expected because step feedback is a much more severe effect on the star formation. So basically we are losing the very low mass halos at those fainter side of UV luminosity function, and that is the turnover is basically the consequences of that. So this is basically my summary of the talk. So we have modeled the effect of inhomogeneous recombination and radiative feedback using Swift, and we have seen that both recombination and radiative feedback delay the reionization process, that is reionization end shifts toward lower rate shifts, and this also suppresses the amplitude of large scale 21 centimeter power spectra. And we have explored different reionization models using this modified script and the available observational constant. We have seen that our models prefer a late reionization end. And in future, we'd like to extend the applicability of script towards higher rates, that is toward to include the cosmic dawn physics and so on. So thank you. I would like to stop here.
Thanks, Varun. The floor is open for question. Yeah, Vinash, please go ahead.
Yeah, hi Varun. Nice talk. Can you go to the slide where you showed the power spectrum, the red and the blue curves?
Yeah, this one.
Yeah, are they on the same at the same reionization history? Same redshift.
Same reionization history. Yeah.
Okay, but I can see that it is kind of more or less a scaling between these two. The power spectrum shapes look similar. So I was wondering what can cause that. Why there is a one-to-one, there is a scaling we can see there.
Yeah, but qualitatively there's the suppression at large scale is much larger in comparative, if you compare the small scale.
Okay, so you are interested in the large scale.
Yeah, sure.
And but still there, the... Okay, I think we can discuss it later.
Yeah. So why this blue car suddenly dropped?
Oh, this is the resolution. It is a coarser resolution.
Okay, but the dashed line...
Dash line is for higher resolution. So delta X basically gives the size of the grid. So you can see that dash one for 4 H inverse NPC and the solid one is for 8.
Yeah, Avinash, you have another question?
No, sorry.
Okay. Yes,
sorry.
Okay. Any other question?
If not, can I ask?
Yeah, please go ahead.
Okay, so these code do not if you change the box size or if you change the resolution, the power spectrum does not change, right?
Yeah, at large scale.
And then reionization history also does not change, right?
Yeah, I mean it's more or less consistent with each other.
Okay, thanks.
Any other question? We still have 1 minute. Desh, please go ahead. Desh,
took time to mute. So while you mentioned, certainly there is significant difference once you include recombination. Apart from the delayed, you also mentioned there is suppression of the signal. What is the level of that suppression? Can just quantify that?
That actually basically depends upon this parameter the clumping factor that basically gives the strength of recombination. So it will depend upon that. In general, in the literature, people use the clumping factor of 3. For the factor of 3, these plots are shown basically.
Oh, okay. All right, so I'm trying to figure out which one I should be looking at to see the strength reduction.
Yeah, any of the panels. Will this stay for gradual or more or less?
Okay, so it's almost, at times it's almost an order of magnitude, right?
Yeah.
Okay. All right, thanks.
Yeah, we may open the floor for discussion with, about all the talks today. I would like to thank the speakers in this session, Chandra, Atri, and Varun. And let's open the floor for discussion about any of the talks.